Welcome to Coldwell Mennonite Church for a Sunday morning worship for January the 29th. It's good to be with you again this morning to worship our God. This morning we will read the scriptures. We'll sing together. There'll be a message from the Word of God from Pastor Richard, and then we will celebrate communion together. Now, if you're at home and you're listening along at home, we invite you to celebrate with us, to prepare a little bit of juice and a piece of bread, so that when the time comes, you'll be able to celebrate with us. We want to start this morning with a call to worship from Zephaniah chapter 3, from verses 12 to 17. And I want to read this responsively with you. "But I will leave within you the meek and humble. The remnant of Israel will trust in the name of the Lord. Sing, daughter Zion. Shout aloud, Israel. Be glad and rejoice with all your heart, daughter Jerusalem.
The Lord has taken away your punishment. He has turned back your enemy. The Lord, the King of Israel, is in with you. Never again will you fear any harm."
On that day, they will say to Jerusalem, "Do not fear, Zion. Do not let your hands hang limp. The Lord your God is with you,
the mighty warrior who saves. He will take great delight in you. In his love, he will no longer rebuke you, but will rejoice over you with singing."
Imagine that, that God rejoices over us with singing. Let's pray. Lord, to know you, to be in your presence, to worship you is indeed a joyful thing, a wonderful thing, to know that we are your children and you are our Father. Such things are too wonderful, but such things encourage us to continue. Lord, make us ever more your people. And as we sing to you, Lord, we remember you rejoice over us with singing. Amen. Let's sing as the Lord sings over us. Let us sing to him and to each other. Music team, please.
Good morning, everybody. If you are able to, please join me and stand in singing number 28. If you voice it together, you'll see on the slides.
Thank you.
turn to your Hosanna book, number 64.
Thank you, music team. Our Bible is old, it's ancient, but it's also relevant still. We have communion this morning, and I found a beautiful poem that I want to read to you now. It's called Communion. You can follow along on screen. Immersed within your thinking, growing tender to your ways, beholding with my heart true beauty on which to gaze. Caught up within your heart, a love's embrace I know, but gift without the giver, desire not you bestow. O joy of joy sublime, as wake more to your love, together knit in union, to do as done above. It's a beautiful poem about being together and with God and his love for us. Let's continue to sing now.
If you are able to, please stand again and join us in the blue hymnal for number 167, God's Beloved.
Thank you.
go to Voices Together, number 466, and the music will be up on the screen.
Please be seated. We want to read scripture now before Pastor Richard comes with his message, the love of God. From Ephesians chapter 5, verse 1 to 2. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. And then from the book of Psalms 103, starting from verse 8. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. Church, let's pray for Pastor Richard before he comes. Heavenly Father, we pray for our pastor that you'll give him words to say. Beautiful words from you about your love. May we listen and believe in Jesus' name. Amen. Richard.
and this morning. And I decided to go to this mic for the sermon. Today is a special day, as Eric has mentioned. We want to serve communion. Most churches observe what is called, or what we call ordinances, in the evangelical churches at least. And those generally are baptism and communion. And so these are ordinances, are special ceremonies that have special meaning and have been instituted by Christ himself. However, Christ did not stipulate the exact form that these are to take and so on. And so there's a great variety of ways and frequencies in how these are practiced, and even within the EMC itself. And so today we have planned to have the communion service. In the EMC circles, we've often referred to that as the Lord's Supper as well. But the communion service is laden with a lot of meaning, very deep service, really. It speaks of Christ dying for our sins, speaks of forgiveness of sins. It speaks of fellowship we have with God, and the fellowship we have with the body of believers, and talks of love. It talks about looking forward to the Lord's second coming, and so forth. There are other issues as well. Today I want to look at how it shows that God loves us, as we have the text was read for us, Ephesians 5, 1 and 2, and that's the main text I want to use. Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly beloved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us. Look to God, he says. Be like him. Now, what is God like? And this morning, when Eric read about God singing over us, it's kind of a new aspect. We don't think about God singing. I wonder what voice he is. Is he an alto or a tenor, or is he bass? Peter says bass, so maybe he sings all four voices at the same time. Anything is possible, I think it would be. I would sure love to hear that sound. But anyways, here we have brought out that God is love. And that's what we want to concentrate on this morning. And I think we have even some PowerPoints here to go with that. For God is love. C.S. Lewis always has some good quotations. He says, on the whole, God's love for us is a much safer topic or subject to think about than our love for him. And that may be true, but I think it's still a necessary topic to think about. It may be, maybe we think it's a safe topic to think about because we all like to think of God as sort of that kindly old gentleman up in the sky someplace who lovingly gives us all we want, and he never demands anything of us. But that does not really mean that we have a right understanding of his love. It is interesting, but also I think also very important to note that first of all, that not only does God love, but he is love. We have in 1 John chapter 4 a number of verses that speak of this, but I have one example here in verse 8. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Now, I should maybe throw in there that the opposite is not necessarily true. You know, love is God. Does not actually work. I read of one pastor in Ontario who claims that she doesn't actually believe in God. She says that love is God now, so that's all we need. But anyways, that's a different topic. But here we find that God is the source of love, but he's also love in his very inmost being. Now, this is not easy for us to grasp. This means that not only does he do loving things, but that he is love through and through. He is love always and ever. Every word, action, and thought of his is permeated always with love. Now, I've had people say to me, actually, that in effect, they believe that God is sort of two-faced, sort of a Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde approach. One fellow said to me once that, sure, God is loving and merciful now, but just wait till the end. Someday, then God is going to let go of all his pent-up anger, and he's going to make the unbelievers suffer like crazy. And he will rule, he said, with a rod of iron. Now, Scripture does talk of God's wrath and justice and so on, but it also tells us that God remains the same. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He does not change from love one day and then become anger the next day. Rather, he is totally love, even in his anger. And so I'm going to say something that's maybe might set you back a bit. I don't know. But it's a bit risky. And so if I follow this kind of thinking, even hell, rightly understood, has to then be an expression of God's love. Now, we don't have time to look at it really, you know, totally in depth, but rather briefly, we could say that hell is where God, in his love, allows people to go who don't want to have anything to do with him. Just look at a number of those verses in Romans 1 and 2, and he talks about how God has given over the ungodly to wrath. He's given them over to that and so forth. Now, the other big issue in connection with God's love that is often raised is in regards to all the sufferings in this world. How can God be love if my child died, you know, in a very bad sickness and so on? Or if millions are starving? And many indeed have decided to throw God overboard in view of this question. And no doubt it is a difficult question. No easy answers for this one. However, in response to this question, and I don't intend to totally answer it satisfactorily this morning, but I think there are two important factors that we need to consider when we look at that question of all the suffering and so on in this world. First of all is our sin, and with that also our free will. God's plan was for a world in which the beings that he created would freely and willingly love him and be in relationship with him. Again, in his love, he has to let us follow our own choices. We have free will to sin. And he doesn't stop us if that's the way we want to go. And so a huge amount of suffering, and I'm not saying all suffering necessarily in this world, is due to this factor. People do it to themselves, or they do it to each other. And so if God forced us to quit all these things that cause suffering, we would in effect become robots and not human beings. And so that's a factor in this question. Then next, the cross of Christ has to be considered. Our text today highlights this factor. If God did not care at all, or if he had been able to work things out in some other way, surely he would not have endured coming to earth as a human, and then suffered a humbling death on the cross. I want to read some words from a writer who wrote this some 600 years ago. And they were written about our love, but they show us something about God's love too, I believe. It's from Thomas Kempis. To love at all is to be vulnerable. Love anything, and your heart will certainly be wrung and possibly be broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give your heart to no one, not even to an animal. Wrap it carefully around with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Lock it up safe in the casket or coffin of your selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken, but it will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. The only place outside heaven where you can be perfectly safe from all the dangers of love is hell. So God did not keep his heart in a casket. He made himself vulnerable. His heart was wrung. It was broken. This is the evidence of his great love for us. And so these are important truths as we seek to be like God, as our text says. You know, often we tend maybe to think about God as kind of a demanding tyrant who is never satisfied with our behavior. Sit up, stand straight, wipe that smile off your face, do this, do that, smarten up, pray more, give more, read the Bible more, go to church more, and on it goes. And we become discouraged. You know, I know in the past at one church, I know we were accused of being too legalistic, not enough of God's grace in our preaching and teaching. Now, if we are guilty of this, it's our own fault and not God's. We can easily become more legalistic than God, much more demanding. One of my favorite scriptures is Psalm 103. Really, all the whole chapter. But for today, we had while Eric read there verses 8-14, and note there the way God is portrayed. The Lord is compassionate and gracious. He's slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse. He does not treat us the way our sins deserve. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As a father has compassion for his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. He remembers that we are dust. He doesn't expect more of us, you know, than is reasonable. Richard Helverson, who was the chaplain of the United States Senate, once said, "There is nothing you can do to make God love you more. There's nothing you can do to make God love you less. His love is unconditional, impartial, everlasting, infinite, perfect." And so God is not a demanding tyrant waiting to pounce on you the minute that you step out of line. You know, if you happen to say a swear word or you inadvertently take home a pen from the office, he does not toss you out the back door because of that. You know, there's been an ongoing debate in Christian circles about whether you can lose your salvation. Now, I say that's not a good question. I say that it's not that you lose your salvation, as if you know, God looks down on Richard and he's doing this and he's doing this, and then he does this. Now I'm going to cut him off. You know, he's out the door. But rather, as we said before, God has given us a free will, and we can choose to reject God. I think that free will remains with us as long as we're alive. And so he will not force us to be one of his people. If we turn aside from him, he will not keep us and force us to be his. But whichever side you're on this issue, I think the Bible is quite clear that we can trust in Christ. He will not throw us out at the drop of a hat. Salvation is not a matter of kind of jumping in and out on a daily basis. A couple of weeks ago, I think it was, we looked at this at Romans 8. Neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. He always loves us. Now, having said this, you probably guessed it, we have to say something else to this as well. All of this does not mean that it doesn't matter what we do. Howard Snyder quotes part of an old song. It wasn't actually familiar to me, but apparently it's a fairly popular song in some circles. But the song goes, though it makes him sad to see the way we live, he'll always say, I forgive. And Howard says, this is really fuzzy romanticism and cheap grace. It's not the good news of Jesus Christ. Yes, God's love is unconditional. It doesn't matter who we are, what we do. He continues to love us to the depths of his very being. He died for us that while we were in our sins, that is, while we were in rebellion against him. But real love still has some conditions. We love our children very dearly, but we require certain conditions, obedience and respect and so on. They do certain chores and this and that. A wife loves her husband unconditionally, but will not put up with an extra partner on the side. God loves us unconditionally, but right at the start he said to Adam and Eve, you shall not eat of that tree. He gave the Ten Commandments later on. These were all given out of love because, let's say, the Ten Commandments, they were an expression, or it shows us how we can best love God and how we can love each other. The rules are not there for us to somehow earn our salvation, but they tell us what love looks like. Jesus says in John 15, you are my friends if you do what I command. When we walk in God's ways, we show that we understand and that we are in a family relationship with him. And so, let's look on our following God's example as a privilege. It's a privilege to become more like our Father. You know, I appreciate it when people compare me to my father. My preaching, as some people have told me, reminds me of my father's preaching. He was also a pastor for some years. And so that's an honor. It's an honor for us also to resemble our Heavenly Father. Those who we want to imitate, that's who we want to imitate. We want to be like him. These points that we have looked at today are not meant to be burdensome to us. God did not want to load something on us that would take all the fun out of life. When we tell the truth, and some of this refers to Ephesians earlier on in that passage that we were read there, where he says to tell the truth and so on, When we tell the truth, when we watch our language, when we control our anger and so forth, we are doing ourselves a favor. God and His love knows that. We can do no better than to commit ourselves to a lifestyle that follows His example, and to do so with joy. And so that's what we want to celebrate today. Jesus said one time, he said, and it's an interesting phrase here in the King James version. He says, "With desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you." With desire, I have desired. That's an interesting term. Apparently, it brings out a very strong, very, very strong desire in Jesus. And so Jesus wanted to do this with his disciples. And so, realizing the great love of our Father, we can approach this communion with a similar desire. God loves us through and through. That's the attitude that we go into this service with. And communion speaks to and illustrates in a powerful way that love that God has for us. We can come here to the communion table though we feel too sinful, we feel inadequate, we feel too weak, we feel rejected, or we feel unworthy. But we can come because God loves us dearly in spite of all those things. And so we want to celebrate now together this service of love that Christ has instituted for us. And so I'll turn this over to
Okay, it's important that we hear, isn't it? So sorry about that. Yeah, so Jesus took bread and he gave thanks and said, "Take and eat, this is my body." And so we will distribute the bread, and if you can just wait till everybody has received it, and then we'll eat together. There is gluten-free bread in the little container on there for those that need that. All received the bread. Let's pray together. Gracious Father, we thank you that your Son, Jesus, gave his body for us on the cross. His body was broken so that we could be healed and live together in unity. In the presence of Christ, your Son, we now eat together. Amen. Let's eat together. Then we read in Matthew 26, verse 27, and then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. Servers will serve the cups, and the juice is on the outside, and the wine is on the inside for those that whatever you want. have all been served? Let's pray together. Gracious Father, we thank you that your Son, Jesus Christ, lovingly gave his blood for us on the cross. By this gift of his life, we have the forgiveness of our sins and a restored covenant with you, our Creator. By the gift of his blood, we stand clean, whole, and strong in your presence. In the presence of your Christ, your Son, we now drink together. Amen. Drink together. So with that, we come to the end of the service, and I would like to close in the benediction. It comes from 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 16 and 17. Let's bow together. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, may he encourage your hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and word. Amen.